In the first day of this unit, we looked at 15th century Florence and the birth of what is usually termed the early Renaissance. Today, confusingly, we're jumping back in time and looking at a period that is sometimes referred to as late Italian Gothic and sometimes as the Proto-Renaissance. But first, a little historical background. Italy took a somewhat different path through the Middle Ages. Remnants of the Roman Empire lived on more strongly here, and of course, Italian artists could study Roman sculpture firsthand. The areas of Europe that would eventually become France and Germany were ruled by kingdoms. Italy, by contrast, was a collection of city-states. Some, like Naples and Milan, were basically small kingdoms, but others, including Siena and Florence, where we'll be hanging out today, were republics. This does not mean they were democracies. These city-states were all oligarchies, that is, they were ruled by the wealthy few. The Medici video gave some of you a glimpse into this world. It was in Italy that the first great work of literature in the vernacular, that is, the commonly spoken language, appeared. Dante's Divine Comedy. Moreover, as Byzantium came under more and more threat from the Ottoman Turks, Greek scholars fled to Italy and brought with them Greek classical texts that had largely disappeared from Western Europe. This altarpiece, not a required work, is painted in what was dubbed at the time the maniera greca, or Greek manner, and what art historians now call Italo-Byzantine style. It was heavily influenced by these immigrants fleeing Byzantium, who brought their art and artistic techniques with them. We're not going to talk much about Italo-Byzantine art since it's disappeared from the College Board list, but let's take a moment for review. What Byzantine features do you observe? Well, the figure of St. Francis is fully frontal and elongated. He has that long, thin Byzantine nose and the wide, staring eyes, almond-shaped. His feet seem to be floating on the surface, and the space he occupies is linear and flat. It's really not a three-dimensional space at all. The gold leaf indicates the saint's otherworldly state, a little ironic for the very down-to-earth St. Francis, while the accompanying images tell stories from his life. In other words, this looks a lot like an icon. But the real reason I included this non-required about the Franciscans, a religious order that, along with another teaching order, the Dominicans, transformed religious life, first in Italy and then throughout Europe. This painting dates from only 9 years after St. Francis's death, a testament to the immediate and enormous impact that this saint had on Christendom. I think most of you know about St. Francis, how he renounced his considerable worldly goods, how he preached respect for God's natural creation. In Italy, huge congregations flocked to hear St. Francis and his followers preach. Rejecting abstract symbolism and complicated theology, Franciscans preached in stories. They wanted to bring the gospel quite literally down to earth. We will see this narrative captured most dramatically in the transformative art of Giotto. But first, here are a couple of the most famous scenes from St. Francis's life, from the same altarpiece you just saw, Italo-Byzantine style. You know the story of St. Francis preaching to the birds, right? And here he is receiving the stigmata, or wounds, of Christ. This famous painting by Giotto, less than 70 years later, is not a required work, but Giotto's paintings are so distinctive and recognizable that they've been ECB favorites for attribution questions in the past. So, what differences do you see between the two depictions of the same scene, the Italo-Byzantine version on the right and the Proto-Renaissance Giotto version on the left? Well, Giotto's St. Francis actually has a body underneath his cloak. His figure has mass and weight. Both he and the figure of Christ have very human faces. The landscape, while not precisely naturalistic, note the sky is still gold, bears a much closer resemblance to nature. But the painting is still largely iconographic. The perspective is way off. We haven't arrived at the Renaissance yet. What really stands out to me and what made Giotto such a perfect artist for the Franciscans is that this is a very human St. Francis. We see his wonder. We see his fear. This is a saint we might have encountered on the street or in the fields. A godly man, to be sure, but a man. I've clipped the face from the Berlinghieri altarpiece and stuck it in the upper right just to help you make the comparison. The Byzantine elements and the departure from Byzantine elements become clearer when you compare this Italo-Byzantine Madonna by Giotto's teacher, Cimabue, with our Byzantine Theotokos, or Mother of God icon. So what similarities and differences do you see? There are a lot of facial similarities, including that narrow face and nose, Yet for all this stylized formality, I think Cimabue's work is a little less forbidding. This is the Gothic Mary, more human and more approachable. But that comparison is still far less striking than this comparison between Cimabue and his most famous student, Giotto. There are obviously a lot of similarities in theme and composition, but what differences do you see? Well, the architecture of the throne comes a little closer to spatial reality. It actually wraps around the Madonna, enclosing her. Her head is upright, which is a break from tradition. She's looking right at us, engaging us in the moment. The angels are likewise more varied and seem to stand more clearly on a ground plane. The overlapping gives a greater sense of depth. Mary, too, has a real body. We see the curve of her breasts and her knees poke out. Neither painting is really in the earthly realm, but it's easier to locate ourselves in the Giotto. We are standing below Christ, looking up. Cimabue's figures, by contrast, seem mostly to float in space. But again, what really stands out to me is the human emotion of Giotto's Mary, almost smiling, almost ready to speak to us. Both painters use chiaroscuro to show modeling, but Giotto's Mary has more volume and more depth. Let me make a quick point about painting techniques. What medium was used to create the Theotokos icon we just saw? Encaustic, that is, wax mixed with pigments so that it would stick to wood. By late Gothic times, painters were more likely to use egg-based tempera, which also adhered to wood. Tempera produced brilliant colors, but it also dried very quickly, which posed a challenge to painters. Oil paint, which we'll encounter soon, dries more slowly and is easier to blend. So oil paintings are not quite as reliant on line to define shapes and establish volume. Stay tuned. Okay, finally, we get to our required work. I'm not going to give you much background about the Arena Channel, since I hope you watched 3 homework videos about this extraordinary masterpiece, and you're about to hear from Sister Wendy as well. Basically, the Arena Chapel was built in Padua, another of the Italian trading cities that accumulated great wealth in this period. These photos show the two ends of the chapel, one showing the Last Judgment, the other Annunciation. Back to Sister Wendy and a longer video clip which will give you a close-up look at several of the paintings in the chapel, including our required lamentation. Well, we need to get on to our required image, but let's take a quick look at a few more images from the Arena Chapel. I mentioned Giotto's close association with the Franciscans and their emphasis on Christian narratives anchored in the everyday lives of people. So what kind of narrative details do you see in this painting? Well, Giotto captures the drama of people removing their cloaks with 3 sequential figures set up in a diagonal line to grab our attention and to create drama. I love the man climbing the tree for a better view. Here, from the upper panel in the chapel, is Mary's father, Joachim, visited in a dream by an angel who announces the coming birth of a child. If you saw this image on an AP test, what clues would identify it as a Giotto? Well, note the modeling, the volume of both Joachim and the shed. I especially like the way Giotto uses highlights to give Joachim an actual butt. The angel's dynamism is heightened by foreshortening. I'm not going to even bother to label this one. You all recognize the scene. Here, Mary, young and tender, reaches for a baby who, well, almost looks like a real baby. So what unusual device does Giotto use to draw us into the painting, to put us right in front of the scene? Note the figures with backs to the viewers. That's a Giotto innovation. And again, it draws us into the picture plane. Note that we are looking up. We are standing below Mary and the Christ child, as is appropriate. So what's wrong visually with the depiction of space? Well, Joseph is in front of Mary, but he's smaller. The mountains are too flat. Giotto's landscapes tend to be idealized, although they're moving toward realism. Here again, we see the intense emotion, the narrative drama, and the use of chiaroscuro, especially highlighting, to capture volume and space. But what I really love about this is how Giotto used the spears and torches to add diagonal drama to the scene, to add tension. Okay, finally, our required image. So what's going on in the panel on the left, and why is it there? The narrative paintings are separated by decorative panels that imitate architectural columns, but also juxtapose Old and New Testament stories. Here we see Jonah being swallowed by a whale, which was interpreted as prefiguring Christ's death and entombment. Here's a blown-up version. Notice that the fish has some personality. You've already heard a lot about this image, and we're going to run out of time, but what I'd like to focus on for a few minutes is style. What techniques does Giotto use to build this painting? How is it composed? How does he use line and color? How does he create a sense of three-dimensional space in a two-dimensional image? So take a few minutes, if you have them, to talk about what you see and how Giotto uses the elements of form to put his message across and to draw us into the painting. So I'll just make a few observations, which you may have already made. The painting contains dramatic diagonals that lead our eye up to the solitary dead tree, probably representing the fatal tree in Eden, whose curse is about to be overcome by Christ's death and resurrection. The diagonal also leads us to the focal point and climax of the composition, the grieving Mary holding her son. Giotto has varied the postures of the figure, which adds interest and drama. He also uses complementary colors to draw our eye, Mary Magdalene's red skirt against the cloak of the figure beside her, and the blue and orange of the figures immediately above. The astonishing blues of the Arena Chapel, by the way, reflected not only the patron's desire, also his wealth. The patron wanted the chapel to be painted in a brilliant blue, reflecting the heavens and also a color traditionally associated with Mary. The pigment was made by grinding up lapis lazuli, but the cobalt blue couldn't be applied directly to wet plaster. It would absorb too much of the expensive pigment. So Giotto mixed it with egg yolks and applied it on top of the dried frescoes, a method known as secco fresco. Unfortunately, the paint did not bind as well and it began to peel. I didn't assign the Khan Academy video on The Last Judgment. I'm sure you're sorry to hear that. It's painted on the entrance wall. Unlike The Lamentation, this is not considered one of Giotto's greatest works, and art historians actually think that much of it was painted by his assistants. But there are a couple of elements that we should note, if only in passing. The Arena Chapel's patron, Scrovegni, features prominently among the saved. Giotto knew who was writing his paycheck. Here we see the patron presenting the chapel to the three Marys. And it wouldn't be a Last Judgment without a deliciously scary devil, would it? But on a more technical note, why does it look a little like a patchwork quilt? The answer is that frescoes had to be painted quickly before the plaster dried. A giornate is a term for the portion that a painter could paint in a giorno, in a day. Skilled fresco painters learned to disguise the daily divisions, often with architectural features. The rather obvious giornate may be a reason why art historians think that most of this was painted by assistants. Well, I don't have much time to talk about the art of Siena either, but I'm going to, even though the College Board has shockingly dropped this wonderful Proto-Renaissance paintings of Siena from its list. I have a soft spot for Siena. The summer after my junior year in college, I had an internship with the UN in Geneva, Switzerland. On weekends, I used my student rail pass to travel around Switzerland, Italy, and France, sleeping on the train to save money. Anyway, a friend of mine, really a friend of a friend, was spending the 6 months before he started law school backpacking through Europe. He sent me a postcard from Siena and suggested I check it out. He said Siena's even more amazing than Florence and a lot less crowded. I found this hard to believe, at least the more amazing than Florence part, but on his advice, I spent the next weekend in Siena and I loved it. I wrote back to this friend of a friend and asked if he'd like to join me on one of my weekend jaunts. We met up in Antwerp, Belgium, and spent most of our time wandering around its splendid art museums looking at Flemish art. We also got to know each other better that weekend, and anyway, I've now been married to the guy for almost 40 years. But since the College Board isn't requiring me to describe Siena's paintings in any technical detail, I'm going to let Sister Wendy introduce you to one of my favorite Siena's painters and paintings, and to talk about the emerging Republican culture of Siena and Florence. I love Sister Wendy. I own several of her books and have watched the entire Story of Painting series several times, but she is deliciously easy to parody. So if you have time, as a final treat, here is Sister Randy.